This video is designed to give you more information about what to expect if you are having radial forearm free flap surgery. Please note, not all the information may be applicable. If you have any questions that are not covered in this video, please ask your surgeon. You may be somebody who has or is going to have a defect, hole, in the head and neck region. This may be because you have undergone or are due to undergo cancer surgery because you have sustained trauma following an extensive infection or a defect that has been present since birth, amongst other reasons. These defects can be addressed in a variety of different ways depending on their size, type of tissue we are trying to reconstruct, the surrounding tissue, and other factors such as your overall medical health and fitness for surgery. If the hole is small, sometimes it is suitable to leave the body to heal by itself. Other times, the hole can be reconstructed using tissue from nearby. One of the common ways of filling or reconstructing a defect or hole in the head and neck region is by using a free flap. A flap is the transfer of tissue from one site, the donor site, to another, the recipient site, with its own blood supply. For head and neck defects, we commonly use the radial forearm free flap. There are other alternatives to using this flap, which has its own advantages and disadvantages. You can discuss this further with your surgeon. However, the radial forearm free flap is one of the most reliable for reconstruction in the head and neck region. This involves taking tissue, skin, and fat from near the wrist along with blood vessels, an artery, and two or three veins. We can do this safely because the forearm is supplied by two arteries, the ulnar artery and the radial artery. Before we perform the surgery, we will perform a test, an Allen's test, to make sure that there will be enough blood supply to the hand from the ulnar artery, and it is safe to do so if the radial artery is taken. We will only perform the operation if this is the case. Once we have harvested the tissue from the wrist with the blood supply, we will take this to the recipient site where the defect is. This tissue will be inset to reconstruct the defect. The vessels of the flap will be joined or plumbed into suitable vessels in the neck using a microscope, giving the newly transferred tissue its own blood supply. This blood supply will keep the flap alive whilst it heals in its new place. We often cover the defect in the wrist by using excess skin from the stomach or elsewhere, and this is called a skin graft. There is enough mobility and excess skin around the stomach that we can take this without causing any significant problems. Occasionally, only partial thickness of the skin is harvested from other sites, such as the thigh. What to expect after your operation? We will monitor the transferred tissue from the wrist closely over the next few hours and days to ensure that there is no issues with the plumbing. We do this by looking at the flap for a healthy color, feeling for a good blood supply, and listening for a healthy blood flow, which assesses the joining of the vessels. If a problem is identified, we may have to take you back to the operation theater. We look at the appearance of the flap. We feel for color return. We listen for artery and/or vein sounds. We have a machine that detects blood flow through the artery or vein. This is known as a Doppler. This monitoring Doppler is usually removed after 7 days. The blood vessels lifted with the flap run from the inside of the wrist as far as the inside of the elbow, so there will be a row of stitches along this line which will be taken out when the bandage is removed. You may have a plastic tube to coming out of the arm to collect any excess fluid that may build up, and this will usually stay 1 or 2 days. Your arm will be placed in a bandage and sometimes in a split cast, and this helps improve the success rate of the skin graft. This will usually be the case for 7 to 10 days. It is best to avoid excess movement of the fingers in the first couple of weeks, as this will allow the skin graft to gain its own blood supply and increase the success of it taking. All surgery carries risks, but your surgical team will try and minimize these. Pain. This is usually temporary and can be managed with painkillers. Bleeding. Most bleeding will be controlled during the surgery. You may have a drain to collect the excess blood, but sometimes a collection of blood under the skin, called a hematoma, that can be managed in different ways, including evacuation under anesthesia. Infection. Infection can happen with any surgery. It is often treated with antibiotics, but in rare cases, it may require prolonged treatment, additional surgeries, or hospitalization. Scarring. Scarring is common, and if troublesome, can be managed with additional treatments. Swelling. Swelling is common, and usually subsides in the days and weeks following surgery. Bruising. Bruising is common and typically settles. Nerve damage, numbness, paresthesia, tingling, altered sensation. There are nerves nearby the flap, of which most at risk is the one that supplies sensation to the thumb and nearby area. You may get some altered sensation following surgery due to bruising of the nerve, which is likely to resolve but may be permanent. In about 5% of cases, the transferred flap can develop problems which are usually due because a clot has developed. If there is no fresh blood going into the flap, or there is a problem with the outflow of blood with the flap, it can lead to the flap failing. If this does happen, it is most likely to happen in the first 48 to 72 hours. And this is why we monitor the flap closely during this period. If it does happen, we may have to take you back to the operating room to see if the problem can be resolved. Removing the clot is not always successful, and on these occasions the flap fails and an alternative method of reconstruction sought. Graft failure. There is a risk of graft failing which can expose the underlying structures, which may require dressing changes or additional surgery. Need for further surgery. Risks of general anesthesia. For more information, please speak to your surgeon or visit the following websites.